subject is programming in Java, and this course has been done in MCA third semester. Today we will discuss introduction to Java program. So the learning objectives for today are structure of a Java program, compiling and running the program, types of programming errors, lexical issues, data types, literals, typecasting, operators, and then we will discuss control statements. So first topic is structure of a Java program. So everything in Java is inside a class. So this is the basic structure of a Java program. Class is a keyword, and then we have to write the name of the class. Then we have to start the block of the class, and inside that, because I am saying that everything in Java is inside the class, that means our main function is also inside the class. In case of C++, when we are saying it is an object-oriented programming language, in case of C++, the main function was outside the class. But in case of Java, everything is inside a class, so our main function is also included in the class. So this is a syntax for writing the main function: public, static, void, main, and we have to pass one array of string type arguments, and inside the block of main we can write the statements. Then we have to close the block of main, and then we have to close the block of our class. Now what is the meaning of this public and static? As we already know, void is the return type of our main function. That means main will return nothing. But why we have used this public and static in case of Java? See, when a function is inside a class, now the compiler will start the compilation from the main function. So we want to access this function from outside the class. That's why we have made it public, so that it can be accessed from anywhere. So this is the access specifier for this particular function. Now why we have made it static? Now static keyword has been used so that this main function can be called without instantiating the object of class, this class in which it has been included. So that's why it is public and static. Now what is the meaning of this string array? Now when we want to pass the arguments from command line, in that case those arguments are passed to the main function in the form of strings. Now why we have taken the array? Because we do not know how many arguments a user can pass. He or she can pass one argument, he or she can pass 10 arguments. So the size of the array has not been initialized, so that its size will be dynamic. If the user is passing 10 arguments, then it will take the size of 10. Otherwise it will specify the size, initialize the size as per the arguments passed, and it will always take input in the form of string. So when we want to use the value of command line argument, suppose the user has passed integer, but those integers will come as a string, so we have to typecast. So that thing we will discuss afterwards, what is typecasting. So this is the basic structure of our class. Now this is the example program. We have taken the class, name of the class is first, and we have written one statement, system.out.println. See, in case of C++, to display the message on the monitor, we were using cout statement. Now in case of Java, println is the function that we use to display this message onto the screen. Now everything is Java is inside the class, so that means this function has already been defined in some inbuilt class. Now how to access the functions that are defined inside a class? We need a object name dot the function name. So println is a function, and out is the object of output stream class, that is an inbuilt class, and that's why we are writing out dot println. Now system, this output stream is defined inside the system class. So system is the inbuilt class. That's why we are writing this system.out.println. defined inside the system class. Inside the system class there is the output stream class, and we have used the object of output stream and then the name of the function. So this what is the objective of this function? The objective of this function is to display the hello message. Now how to save this program? We have to save this program with an extension .java. So .java is the extension of a Java program file. Now what should be the name of the file? See, you can have multiple classes inside the inside a single program. So the class that is containing the main method, the name of the file should be that one. So in case of this particular program, our main is inside the class first. That's why we have named it as first.java. And one more thing, Java is case sensitive. So if you are writing F capital here, then you have to save like this only. But if you have written here F capital and then you have saved it as small f first.java, then in that case it will not execute. So these things you have to keep in mind. Now how to compile a program? Now it is the process of translating source code written in a particular programming language into computer readable machine code that can be executed. Now Java C is the compiler of Java that will compile the first.java, that is the Java file. And what to write? We have to write Java C space name of the file dot Java, and then we have to press enter. Now this command will produce a file named first.class. So when we will compile this first.java, we will get first.class file, which is used for running the program with the command Java. Now when we will compile, we will get the first.class file, and then how to run that program? We have to run that program with the command Java space name of the Java file without any extension. So this is the way of running and compiling and running the program. Now we have already discussed how to print onto the screen. So system.out.println, it outputs the string hello world followed by a new line onto the screen, because println function is having automatically a new line character itself. And if you do not want to use a new line character after displaying this message, then you can use print function. So this is the difference between println and print, that this print outputs the string hello world on the screen and the string is not followed by a new line. So some escape sequences that you can use if you are using print and you want a new line character, then you can use slash n. Slash t stands for the tab character. Now some tips about programming. Now some common errors in the initial phase of learning programming are mismatch of parentheses. Suppose you have started with a block and you have not ended that block, so that is the mismatch of parentheses. Missing of semicolon. As you already know, every statement should end with a semicolon, and you have missed that semicolon somewhere in the program. And case sensitivity. As we have already discussed, when we are writing with capital F first, then it is different from small f first. So these are the two things, that this and this are two different things in Java, as Java is case sensitive. So the best way to learn programming is writing a lot of programs of your own. So that are some tips about programming. Now next is programming errors. As we already know that there are number of errors, but we are not able to differentiate between those errors. So there are three types of errors. First one is syntax errors, runtime errors, and logic errors. Now syntax errors are detected by the compiler. So when we have written the code and we are compiling, so syntax errors are detected by the compiler itself and they are generated. And runtime errors are the errors that are generated at runtime, so it causes the program to abort. And logic errors that are produced by the incorrect results. That means there is a problem in the logic of the program. So we will discuss one by one. So first one is compilation error, and this is the example of a compilation error. As you can see here, class name. This is the name of the class. Then public static void main string, and we have written I is equal to 30. System dot out dot println I plus 4, and this one statement. Now can you identify the compilation error here? See, when we are writing this s, this is the small s that we have written. So this is the compilation error, because string is a class here, and we can it should be in capital, right? So second is, we have not declared the variable I. We have initialized the variable I, but we have not declared that it is of integer type. So int is missing. So this is the compilation error, example of compilation error, that we have not declared the variable. Now second is runtime errors. In case of runtime errors, you will not get any compilation errors, but it is working fine, and we have generated the dot class file. But at runtime, suppose we have written this statement, int I is equal to 1 upon 0. Now 1 upon 0 is the runtime exception that has been occurred, that is divide by 0 error, and when this statement will be executed, the program will be aborted. So these are the runtime errors. There is no compilation error in this particular program, but there is a runtime error that when we are dividing any number by 0, we will get divide by 0 error. So that is the runtime error. So we have to keep in mind that when runtime error occurs, at that time the program will be aborted at that particular position. Rest of the statements will not be executed. Then the last one, logical errors. So this is the example of logical errors. As you can see, that we have written if radius greater than equal to 0, and we have written everything right. Right? So this particular example will not generate any compilation error or runtime error, but there is a logical error. See, because we have put a semicolon after the if statement. So that is the logical error. This statement will be terminated here. If this condition is true, even then this area will be, these statements will not be executed. So this is the logical error. Now we will start with the lexical issues. Now identifiers. What are identifiers? Are name that we give to a piece of data or a part of the program, the functions or the variables, they are known as the identifiers. So identifiers are useful because they allow us to refer to that data or code later in the program. So identifier gives names to classes, methods and variables. In case of Java, we will not say functions, we will say those functions as methods. So variables can name pieces of data, or that thing we will see later. Now details about identifiers. So Java identifier names, the first character must be a letter or underscore or with dollar sign. So the identifier name should start with the either alphabet or underscore or a dollar. Following characters can be any of these characters or a number. Identifiers are case sensitive. Name is different from name. So if you are writing small name, name with small n and name with capital N, both are different because Java is case sensitive. Now these are the few examples of legal and illegal identifiers. As you can see, these are the legal identifiers because they all are starting either with alphabet or with a dollar sign or with a underscore. But in case of illegal identifier, as you can see here, we have use plus. So we cannot use these operators inside, or we cannot use the special characters. So all these are the examples of illegal identifiers. Keywords. Now an identifier that you cannot use because it is already has been reserved meaning in the Java language. The keywords are already defined in the Java language, so we cannot use these keywords in our program as it is with for different use. So this is a complete list of Java keywords like abstract, boolean, break, if, while, do, throw, thrown. Like these are the keywords that has already been defined, and we cannot use in a different manner in our programs. So you may not use care or while or this or any other keyword for the name of a class or method. Java reserves those words to mean other things. So you could use capital care because small care is defined for the data that we will discuss later on. So we can use these because Java is case sensitive, but we cannot use these keywords in our program for different things. Now, how to declare the comments, define the comments? Comments are the note written in the source code by the programmer to make code easier to understand. Now, comments are not executed when the program runs, and most Java editors turn your comments a special color to make it easier to identify them. Now, you already know, in case of C++, we were using double slash for one single line comment, and for multiple line comments we were using slash asterisk, and we have to end the comment with star slash. So these are the few examples of comments. So this is a single line comment and this is a multiple line comment. Now, how to use the comments? So these are the things that you should know. Comments can be put in many standard places. Most all programs have a comment header at the top of the each file, naming the author, explaining the what the program does. That means you can explain the objective of the program in that, and with the name of the author. Most programmers also place a comment at the start of every method, describing the method's behavior. Method's behavior means what is the functionality of that particular method that has been defined in the comment. Lastly, we can use comments inside methods to explain particular pieces of code. Now, if you want to explain the meaning of a statement, then you can use a single line comment or multiple line comment in a function inside a function. So, comments provide important documentation. Like at this stage in our learning, it is not very useful to write comments because we only know println statements. So we have done only one program, so it is not good for that we should write a comment for that. More complicated programs span hundreds or thousands of lines, and it becomes very difficult to remember that each method is what each method is doing. So comments provide a simple description. When multiple programs work together, comments help one programmer understand the other's code. So these are the few usabilities of your comments. Now these are the few examples of comments. So in this particular comment we have defined that who has written this code, at what time he has written this code, what is the objective of this code. Then we have defined the single line comment in this, which we are specifying that this particular statement is doing display blank line, and this particular comment will display what is the function of this method. Now the next topic that we will discuss is the data types that are available in Java. Now first one is numerical data types. Now numerical data types can be of integer type or floating point type. So as you can see here, double is there, that is the size of double is 64 bits. Float is there, 34, and memory size is 32 bits. Now these are the floating point data types that we can use, and we were using int and long in case of C and C++. But these two new data types have been introduced in Java. First is byte, and it takes only one byte, that means 8 bits memory size. Then second one is short, and its memory size is 16 bits, that means it takes 2 bytes of memory. So these are two new data types that have been introduced in the integer data type, and we can use these. Now next one is character data type. Now in case of C and C++, we were using char keyword for declaring the character type data type. Same is the case here, but the difference lies in the memory size of char data type. Now in case of C and C++, the memory size of char data type was 1 byte. Now in case of Java, it is 2 bytes. as you can see here, it takes 2 bytes of memory. Now, what is the reason behind increasing the size of that character data type? Because Java uses Unicode to represent characters. Unicode defines a fully international character set that can represent all of the characters found in all human languages. So, as you already know that Java is important for the internet, it is working fine on the internet. So, it is more important. So that's why, because on the internet, there are a number of languages that we are using. So, to accommodate all the characters that are defined in different languages, the size of the cat data type has been increased to 2 bytes. And this is an example of how to declare a character variable. We can use single quotes to define the character. And this is the example of Unicode characters that we can define. This is an example of special characters. So this data type has been changed from 1 byte to 2 bytes of memory space. Now this Boolean data type. This data type has been introduced in Java. The keyword that we will use to declare a Boolean variable is Boolean, and it can take either true or false values. So we can define a Boolean variable, a variable of Boolean type with these values. Now, in case of C and C++, true and false means 0 and 1, 1 and 0. But in case of Java, it will not take a true as 1 and false as 0. We cannot write an integer value instead of this one. It will take either true or false. So this is not equivalent to 1 and 0. Now, we will discuss literals. What is a literal? Literal is a constant value that appears directly in the programs. Now we can have integer literals, floating point literals, Boolean literals and character literals. Integer literals. Integer literal can be assigned to an integer variable as long as it can fit into the variable. Compilation error would occur if the literal was too large for the variable to hold. Suppose we have given an example in byte data type, because byte, the size of the byte is 8 bits, and we have assigned a value 1000. It would cause a compilation error because 1000 cannot be stored in a variable of 1 byte. Right? So it will generate a compilation error. Now to specify a long literal, we have to append L, capital L, with the value like this. We have appended this L, that means long. Floating point literals. Now for floating point literals are written with a decimal point. By default, a floating point literal is treated as a double type value. For example, 5.0 is considered a double value, not a float value. You can make the number a float by appending the letter F, small f or capital F, and make a number double by appending the letter small d or capital D. Now, for example, you can use 100.2f. F means float. Now, this is a floating point value. Or you can use capital F also for a float number, and for a double, you can use append d, small d or capital D. Right? So, by default, it will, if you are not specifying F or D with a floating point number, it will take it as a double value. Boolean character and string literals. Now, Boolean literals can take either true or false value, and Java does not equal 1, nor does the false equal to 0, as we have discussed earlier. And the literal character is represented inside a pair of single quotes like this. And a string literal are specified by enclosing a sequence of characters between a pair of double quotes like this. And you already know that string is a set of characters. So we have to embed that string inside the double quotes. Now, next is how to declare a variable. Now, the basic form of variable declaration is, first you have to specify the type, and then you have to specify the identifier, that means its name. And in the same statement, it is optional that you can initialize the value of this identifier. See, what is the syntax? You have to specify the data type, then you have to specify the name of the identifier, Then, if you want to assign a value, then why I have written this square brackets? Because this is optional. Now, we can declare multiple variables in a single statement, like by using comma as a separator. Now, this is a second identity type, and then it is optional. We can specify the, we can initialize the value. Now, you can see the example here. When we are writing int x, that means x is a variable of type int. Radius is a variable of type double. A is a variable of type character. So that is a declaration of a variable. Now, how to assign the values to a variable? We can assign the values to, value to a variable by using the assignment operator, that is equal to. X is equal to 1, that means 1 has been assigned to x. 1.0 has been assigned to radius. A character A has been assigned to A. Now, we can do the declaration and initialization step, two steps in a single process by writing. We have to declare, we have to specify the data type, name of the variable equal to its value. So this is a way of declaring and initializing the variable in a single step. Now, type conversion and casting. Now, what is type conversion or casting? See, when we want to convert one data type, variable of one data type to another data type, that is called type conversion. Now, some automatic type, some implicit type conversions are there and some explicit type conversions are there. Now, the first one is Java's automatic conversion. Now, automatic type conversion will take place if the following two conditions are satisfied. First condition is the two types are compatible. See, one is source data type, another one is destination data type. Now, we want to convert this source data type to the destination type. So, both the types should be compatible. Compatible in the sense that if that is a numeric type, then we can convert that data type. But there is still a restriction. Second condition should be satisfied. That is, destination type is larger than the source type. So, that is the second condition. So, there is implicit casting, as we can see here, double d equal to 3. Now, 3 is an integer and we are assigning this 3 to d, that is of double type. So, that is called widening conversion, because we are converting 32-bit data type to 64-bit data type. So, that's why it is called widening conversion. And it is implicit. When we are converting from a smaller data type to a larger data type, that will occur automatically. Now, casting incompatible types. Casting incompatible types means when numeric types are not compatible with char or boolean types, then also char and boolean types are not compatible with each other. These are the incompatible, casting of incompatible data types. Now, that is called explicit casting. So, the general form of this is, first you have to write the target type in which you want to convert this value. In the bracket you have to write the target type and then the value that you want to convert. And this is the example. Suppose we want to convert a double data type value to integer. So, it is called narrowing conversion, because the size of a double data type is 64 bits, whereas that the size of int data type is 32 bits. So that is called narrowing conversion. And what we have to specify, we have to do it explicitly. And in the bracket we have to write the source data type. Source data type is destination data type is int. Now in the second example, we are converting a character to integer. So it is same as this one. So it will automatically convert it to this one. And when we are converting an integer value, we are assigning an integer value to a character like this, then it is same as this. So, some are explicit, some are implicit. Now, the next topic is operators. So, arithmetic operators are the same that we have already done in C and C++. The basic arithmetic operators are addition, subtraction, multiplication, division and modulo operator. Modulo operator. Now, these are the few examples of your arithmetic operators. We will not discuss addition, subtraction, or multiplication. The main thing that we want to discuss is divide by operator. when we will divide 5 by 2. Now 5 and 2 are both integer values, so it will generate an integer value only. So when we will divide 5 by 2, we will get 2, we will not get 2.5. and when we are dividing a real number, that is a floating point number divided by an integer value, we will get the double value, that is we will get 2.5. so these are the things that you have to keep in mind. Now what is the role of a modulo operator? When modulo operator will return the remainder of after division. So when we are dividing 5 modulo 2, it will yield 1, because when we will divide 5 by 2, the remainder will be 1. So these are the few arithmetic operator that you should know. Now this is the general way of writing a program. When we will write a program in our notebook, we write like this. But this program, this arithmetic expression should be translated to this form. Otherwise, your compiler will generate an error. Now, next is shortcut assignment operators. Shortcut assignment operators are this one: plus equal to, minus equal to, multiply equal to, divide equal to, and modulo equal to. Now what is the meaning of this? When we are writing I plus equal to 8, that means we are incrementing the value of I by 8 and we are assigning that value to I. So that is the basis of your shortcut assignment operator. Same is the case for minus equal to. That means first we will subtract this number and then we will assign that value to F. So you can see here that on the left and right of the these operators, we have the same integers. So same is the case for this one. So these are the shortcut assignment operators. Now increment and decrement operators. Now what are the increment decrement operator? This is your increment operator and this is your decrement operator. See, when we will write x plus plus, that means it is equivalent to x is equal to x plus 1. So the value of x will be incremented by 1 and that will be assigned to x, that will be the new value. And when we are writing, this is the postfix operator and this is the prefix. So when we are writing plus plus x, it is again equal to we are incrementing the value of x by 1 and then assigning the value to x itself. So and in case of decrement, decrement means first we will subtract 1 from the value of x and then we will assign it to x. This is the prefix operator, minus minus x, that means it will first decrement the value of x and then it will return to x. Now these are same whether we are using the postfix operator or whether we are using the prefix operator. So but here you can see the difference why we have used prefix and postfix notation for the increment and decrement operator. For example, if we have a variable I with a value 10 and there is a new variable and we are multiplying 10 multiplied by I plus plus. Now the thing is that what should be done? What will happen? Either the value of I will be incremented or incremented first and then it multiplied by 10, or it will be multiplied by 10 and then incremented. So this particular statement is equivalent to first the value of 10, because we, in this particular case we have used postfix notation of increment, that is I plus plus. So first the value, current value of I will be multiplied by 10 and then the value of I will be incremented. Now as you can see here, this is the postfix notation. When we are saying postfix notation, in that case first the value of I will be incremented and then that incremented value will be multiplied by 10. So this is equivalent to this one. So these are the difference between the postfix and prefix notations. Now next one is relational operators. Relational operators are, these are the relational operators, less than equal to, greater than equal to, double equal to, and not equal to. So we will see these operators. See, these particular operators are used for finding the relation between the two operators that are on the left and right side of the this operator. And the main thing that I want to tell you, what is the difference between single equal to and double equal to? Now single assignment operator that is used to assign a value to a particular variable. When we are using double equal to, that is a comparison operator. Double equal to means comparison operator. That means it will compare the left hand side value with the right hand side value. So that is a comparison operator. So all these relation operators will generate the Boolean value after comparison. Now next is Boolean logical operators. So these are the few logical operators. That is ampersand, that is equivalent to logical AND, or logical OR, negation, exclusive OR, double OR, shortcut OR, double AND, shortcut AND, NOT, logical unary NOT. Then these are the assignment Boolean logical operators. Ampersand equal to, OR equal to, double equal to, not equal to, and last one, that is the ternary operator. Ternary operator is equivalent to if then else. So let us see the truth table for these Boolean logical operator. The truth table for the operator not is equal to when the operand will have true value, not operand will have false. So the value will be opposite. So if it has false, then it will return true. Not means the opposite value of the existing value. Now the truth table for shortcut, circuit, and false false will generate false, false true will generate false, true false will generate false, and true true will generate true. That means if any one of the operand is having a false value, then it will generate a false value. So to get a true value, both the operands should have a true value. Then logical OR. So two operands are there, operand 1 and 2. False, false, it will return false. False, true will return true. True, false return true, and true will give you true. That means in case of logical OR, if we have the operand value of one operand is true, in that case it will return true. Now this is a truth table for this operand, exclusive OR. False false will return false, false true will return true false will return true, and true will return false, because it is equivalent to exclusive OR. Now both this double ampersand and single ampersand, both are the conditional AND operator, logical AND operators. Now what is the difference between these two? Why we are using two different things? And same is the case for this OR operator. Now this is conditional OR operator and this is unconditional OR operator. Now when we are using single ampersand, that means we are using the logical AND operator. In that case, the compiler will check both the sides of operands, right? It will check, it will generate whether it is true or false, whether this is true or false, and then it will compare this value, logical value, with this logical value, and will generate the result. But when we are using this conditional AND operator, in that case, if this value is false, so it will not go to the second operand. It will generate the false statement. Because why it is not going? Because anything, if one operand is false in case of this conditional AND operator, then it will generate false. So it will not check the second condition, whether it is true or false. That is not required, right? So that is the difference between logical OR and logical AND operators. Now the new operators that have been introduced in Java, they are the bitwise operators. Now these operators perform low level operations directly on the binary representation used in integers. So these operators are used basically for applying on the integer bits, that is on the 1 and 0. So you can see here, this is the tip that is used for bitwise NOT, ampersand for bitwise AND, this one for exclusive OR, this is for your bitwise OR, this is your bitwise right shift operator, and this is bitwise left shift operator. We will see the example of these operators, how they will perform the operation. Now this tape means that is your bitwise NOT operator. So NOT operator will if bit 1 is there, then it will be 0 here, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, and the 0 it will become 1 here. So we will get this outcome from after applying this bitwise NOT. Now this is the example of bitwise AND. Bitwise AND, now AND says 1 will return 1, otherwise it will return 0. So 1 1 1 0 1 0 1 1 1 1 1 0 0 0 1 0 0 0 1 0 and 0 0 0. So this is a AND, bitwise AND. Now this is bitwise OR. Bitwise OR says that 0 0 is 0 and 1 1 is 0, rest is 1. So 1 1 is 0, 0 1 is 1, 1 1 0, 1 1 0, 0 0 0, 1 0 1, 0 1 1, and 0 0 0. So these exclusive OR has been defined on two operands. Now this is bitwise OR. So in case of bitwise OR, if any statement is true, then it will return 1 only. So 1 1 is 1, 0 1 1, 1 1 1, 1 1 1, 0 0 0, 1 0 1, 0 1 1, 0 0 0. So when we will do these things, these examples, then you will learn how the bitwise operators work on the low level bits. Now next is bitwise right shift operator. Now what is the role of bitwise right shift operator? The result of right shift is that the first operand is divided by 2 raised to the number of times specified by the second operand. So if we are adding 128, bitwise right shift operator 1, that is equivalent to 128 divided by 2 raised to 1, 1. So it will return 64. Same as example here, if we are using 256 right shift operator 4, that means it will return the result of 256 divided by 2 raised to 1, 4, that is equivalent to 16. Now bitwise left shift operator is opposite of bitwise right shift operator. Now the result of left shift is that the first operand is multiplied by 2 raised to the number specified by the second operand. For example, we have written 128 and bitwise left shift operator 1. That means 128 will be multiplied by 2 raised to power 1 and we will get the result. You can see here in the second example, 16 bitwise left shift operator 2. That means 16 will be multiplied by 2 raised to power 2. That is 4. 16 multiplied by 4 is 64. So this is the working of your bitwise right shift and left shift operators. Now this is the operator presence. So first we have the increment and decrement operator, plus minus, then not, then the rest of the arithmetic operators, then binary addition and subtraction, comparison operators are there, equality and not equal to, unconditional and, exclusive OR, unconditional OR, logical and, conditional OR, and these are the assignment operators. So this is the operator precedence. This is the operator associativity. Now how the an expression is evaluated, that is called the operator associativity. So when two operators with the same precedence are evaluated, the associativity of the operators determine the order of evaluation. All binary operators except assignment operators are left associative. So A minus B plus C minus D is equivalent to evaluating first A minus B, then the result of A minus B is added to C, and this result will be this D will be subtracted from this result. So that is the associativity. Then the assignment operators are right associative. Therefore the expression, this one, A equal to B plus equal to C equal to 5, is equivalent to first the value of 5 will be assigned to C, and then this B plus equal to will be evaluated, assignment operator will be evaluated, and then this result will be assigned to A. So this is the associativity of assignment operators, that is right associative. Now operand evaluation order. The precedence and associativity rules specify the order of the operators, but do not specify the order in which the operands of a binary operator are evaluated. Operands are evaluated from left to right in Java. The left hand operand of a binary operator is evaluated before any part of the right hand operator is evaluated. So you have to keep in mind the associativity rule, precedence rule, and then you will be able to solve the problem. So this operand evaluation is the order is continued. If no operands have side effects that change the value of a variable, the order of operand evaluation is irrelevant. Interesting cases arise when operands do have a side effect. For example, x becomes 1 in the following code because a is evaluated to 0 before plus plus a is evaluated to 1. For example, in this particular case, 0 is assigned to a, and then there is a statement x has been, we are assigning the value a plus 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 a to x. So first a will be incremented, and then that incremented value will be, so it becomes, but x becomes 2. So why it becomes 2? Because a is incremented by 1, so value is 1, and incremented value is 1 here, so 1 plus 1 is 2. So we will get 2 in this the following one, because plus plus a is evaluated to 1 and then a is evaluated to 1. So this is the case. So for today's lecture, we will stop here, and in the next lecture we will start with the